This is side 7 of Tumultuous Times by Father Francisco Radecki and Father Dominic Radecki. George Nevers is your reader for this section, and we'll continue on page 135. The Holy Shroud of Turin. The Templar knight, Geoffrey de Charnay, is believed to have recovered the burial cloth of Christ, the Holy Shroud, during a military campaign in the East. In 1453, Marguerite de Charny, a descendant of Geoffrey, gives the shroud to Anna Lusignano, wife of the Duke of Savoy, who keeps it in Chambéry. The scorched marks visibly seen on the Holy Shroud today occurred when a fire broke out at Chambéry in 1532, partially melting the silver chest housing the sacred cloth. The shroud eventually came to reside in the Cathedral of St. John the Baptist in Turin, Italy, in 1578, where it is honored today. The March 2003 issue of Reader's Digest describes the extensive research that has been done on the Holy Shroud. The Council for Study of the Shroud of Turin's page on the Duke University website says, over 1,000 special tests were conducted, and over 32,000 photographs were taken. These studies combined to make the Shroud of Turin the most intensely studied single object in history. The tests show clearly that the shroud images are not any kind of artistic production, but are the result of physical or chemical changes in the linen fibers themselves. A painting closely resembling the face of the man of the shroud was discovered in Templecombe, England in 1945. This life-size painting was probably modeled on the Shroud of Turin and revered by members of the Knights Templar who had an important outpost and training center there. Today, this painting may be found in the Church of St. Mary the Virgin in Templecombe. The Council of Vienna. The Council of Vienna that brought about the suppression of the Order of Knights Templar was convoked by order of Pope Clement V under pressure from King Philip IV. No other general council of the Church is veiled in such obscurity as that of Vienna. The position that Clement gradually came to take in the affair is shown by his further decrees, one of which ordained that no one should aid a Templar by deed or word, and that the knight who denied the charges should be put to the rack and be compelled to confess. The final decision was to be given in the General Synod of Vienna, which was appointed for the autumn of 1310, but which did not take place till the following year, 1311, because of the long duration of the trial. By far the greater number of the fathers, after the reading of the collected evidence, were of the opinion that the order should be permitted to make a defense, and that it could not be condemned for heresy without offense to God and provision of justice. A small minority, chiefly French, gave their votes for taking immediate action against the order, and, as Philip soon appeared at Vienna and again insisted on its abolition, his influence gave them the victory. First session. Vienne is located on the Rhone River just south of the city of Lyon. The Council of Vienne began on October 16, 1311, and all sessions were held at the Cathedral of Saint Maurice, one of the largest cathedrals in southern France. Politics played a major role in these proceedings, since the Pope and King worked out the final details of the council together. This was the first time in the history of church councils that a monarch decided which prelates were to be present. Even many of the 165 bishops who were invited chose not to attend. 4 patriarchs, 20 cardinals, 29 archbishops, 79 bishops, and 38 abbots and their attendants were present at the council. For obvious reasons, Frenchmen and Italians had the greatest representation, but there were also prelates from England, Germany, Ireland, and Spain. Pope Clement V attended all 3 sessions of the council, while King Philip attended only the 2nd. The Pope's opening discourse enumerated the desired ends of this council: a discussion of the Knights Templar, a new crusade to the Holy Land, the liberty of the Church, and a reform of morals. Following the opening ceremonies, the council recessed until the following April. Second session. Despite the fact that the majority of the bishops opposed the dissolution of the Knights Templar on the grounds of insufficient evidence, Clement V suppressed the order by the papal bull Vox in Excelso during the second session. There is no denying that their wealth, the Knights Templar, had resulted in certain abuses which necessitated a reform, but condemnations based on oral admissions obtained by torture are hard to justify. The rapaciousness of the administration of Philip the Fair accounts for this wicked trial and persecution. The king, however, did not derive all the profit he had expected from his enterprise. A papal bull placed the goods of the temple into the hands of the Hospitallers of St. John of Jerusalem, the Knights of Malta, who put them to good advantage in their warfare against the Turks. But though this was done in Germany, in France and England, most of it went to the crown. In Spain and Portugal, the order was simply refounded under new names. The Hospitallers founded the Hospital of St. John in Jerusalem for sick pilgrims. When they acquired the island of Malta from Emperor Charles V, they became known as Knights of Malta. It seems ironic that the council proposed a crusade and at the same time sought to dissolve the very order of knights that maintained the castles in the Holy Land. The proposed crusade never materialized, since the time of crusades had long passed. Third session. The third session, which lasted 3 days, May 3rd to 6th, 1312, focused on doctrinal matters. The three dogmatic definitions were: number one, the side of Christ was opened after the death of the Savior. Number two, the substance of the rational human soul is truly the form of the human body. Number three, at baptism, children and adults alike receive sanctifying grace and the virtues. Furthermore, Pope Clement V settled the controversy regarding evangelical poverty and approved the rule of the Franciscan order in the constitution Exivi de Paradiso. Other legislation dealt with jurisdiction, duties of bishops, and the management of church property. The council also condemned the concept that usury was not sinful. Peter Olivi, who was the leader of a group of Franciscan spirituals and taught erroneous notions concerning poverty and the relationship of the human body and soul, was condemned during the council. A decree formulated at the third session of the Council of Vienne helped clarify this doctrinal matter. Europe was also plagued with fanatical heretics called Beghards, the male ones, and Beguines, the female ones, who believed they could perform any carnal acts without committing sin. These self-professed saints claimed they had no need to observe ecclesiastical laws and did not have to avail themselves of the Mass or sacraments, since they were already perfect. No external reverence was to be shown to the Blessed Sacrament, since it was beneath their own elevated dignity. The Beghards and the Beguines were condemned at the Council of Vienne. The Feast of Corpus Christi had been established by Pope Urban IV on September 8, 1264, and was later ratified by Pope Clement V at the Council of Vienne. This feast, in honor of the Blessed Sacrament, is still celebrated with great solemnity in traditional Catholic churches throughout the world. Unquestionably, the suppression of the Order of the Knights Templar was a great tragedy. However, the Council of Vienne is still numbered as one of the general councils of the Catholic Church because of its decrees regarding church doctrine and its denunciation of heretics. Pope Clement V's successor, Pope John XXII, wanted the reforms of the Council to be perpetuated. Therefore, after a slight revision, he gave the canons the force of law on October 25, 1317. These canons of the Council were later published, the Clementines, and were added to the existing Code of Canon Law. Chapter 16, The Council of Constance, 1414 to 1418 AD. This council elected Pope Martin V. The Black Death. The era of Constance was one of schism, war, plague, and social change. The Hundred Years' War was raging, three men claimed the papacy, and in England and Bohemia the seeds of Protestantism were being sown. This was also a time of unprecedented devastation throughout Europe as the Black Death gripped the continent during the years 1347 to 1353. To our modern minds, the horrors of this plague seem almost unbelievable. As the plague advanced from town to town, for the rat-filled, unclean cities suffered worst, normal life ceased. Physicians' remedies were powerless. Priests feared to approach the dying and administer the last rites. The doors stood open, and no one dared or cared to enter and rob. At sea, ships manned only by dead sailors drifted derelict. No one knows how many died in the Black Death, for medieval statistics were very emotionally compiled. But when we read that many villages were totally wiped out, that the papal authorities counted 1,500 dead in 3 days in Avignon, that five cardinals, 100 bishops, and 358 Dominicans succumbed in the same city, that at the end the Franciscan losses numbered 124,434, we may credit the specificity and accept the general conclusion that from a third to a half of Europe's population died. This was the greatest calamity ever visited on the Western world. The immediate results of the plague were worse than those of any war. A traveler would find whole villages tumbling into ruin, yielding to the assault of the elements. The countryside was noisome and putrid with dead animals. To the clergy, the Black Death dealt a cruel blow. Conscientious priests administering the last rites ensured their own. Many monasteries were completely wiped out. Petrarch's brother Gerardo, a Carthusian in the monastery of Montreux near Marseille, tended his brother monks and buried them one by one. In the end, only he and his faithful dog were left alive. Dogs generally were more faithful than men. The friars, in particular, caring for the city's sick, suffered appalling losses. Rats hosting infected fleas spread the Black Death and caused feudalism as an institution to vanish. Although many turned to God and prepared for judgment, others, knowing their end was near, relentlessly pursued the pleasures of the passing world. Plague would reoccur every few years for the rest of the 14th and all of the 15th century and initiate an era of depopulation that would last until the 16th century. Nuremberg, Germany, suffered a 10% mortality rate due to good sanitation and hygienic practices. The streets were paved and regularly cleaned. Trash and garbage could not be dumped in the streets but had to be bagged and carted away. Pigs were not allowed to roam the city, and personal cleanliness was held in high regard, an unusual attitude in late medieval Christendom. John Wycliffe and John Huss. Since England lost nearly half its priests to the plague, many unfit and poorly trained men were ordained to fill the decimated ranks. During this troubled time, John Wycliffe, 1324 to 84, and John Huss, 1369 to 1415, emerged to kindle the flames of the Protestant Reformation nearly a century and a half before Martin Luther. John Wycliffe, an English priest, was an anti-Catholic leader who denied the need for the Mass, the sacraments, and a visible church. He, John Wycliffe, next attacked the Catholic doctrine of transubstantiation and the divine institution of the hierarchy, as well as indulgences, auricular confession, extreme unction, and holy orders. The Bible alone, without tradition, was the sole rule of faith. The church was composed only of the predestined. Prayer and sacraments benefited only the predestined, and sins could not harm them. No temporal or ecclesiastical superior had authority when he was in a state of mortal sin. Here we have Calvinism a century and a half before Calvin. His heretical teachings were condemned by the Council of London in 1382, and he, John Wycliffe, was deprived of his professorship at Oxford by royal order. He died 2 years later. Wycliffe was a favorite at the English court, and his circle of influence was extensive. His radical ideology found a new home at the University of Prague when King Richard II of England married Princess Anna, daughter of the Bohemian king, making the two nations allies. John Hus, a Bohemian priest, professor at the University of Prague in 1398, and preacher at the Bethlehem Chapel of Prague in 1402, began to spread Wycliffe's heresies throughout Bohemia. A national independence movement was sweeping the country among nobles and peasants, and the Hussite concepts of rebellion and anarchy were used as a means to destroy German influence and authority. Hus is known for his utter contempt for the Catholic hierarchy and clergy. His teachings were similar to Wycliffe's, except that he believed in transubstantiation. Hus would eventually be ordered to appear before the Council of Constance to answer charges of heresy. The Avignon Popes. Seven successive popes ruled from Avignon, France, a city that from 1309 to 77 was under the jurisdiction of the King of Naples. When King Louis IV of Bavaria invaded Italy and attacked Rome in 1327, he took possession of Naples, banished Pope John XXII, and installed a Franciscan monk as, quote, Pope, unquote, Nicholas V. This anti-pope, 1328 to 1330 AD, was later reconciled with Pope John XXII. Blessed Pope Urban V, 1362 to 1370, one of the Avignon popes, returned briefly to Rome but remained there for only 3 years. Unrelenting war, pestilence, and anarchy left Rome in chaos with a population of a mere 10,000. The move to Avignon was not totally detrimental to the church. Not all the Avignon popes were controlled by the French monarchs, as had been Pope Clement V. Avignon's location on the Rhone River in southern France made it easily accessible for travelers from most European countries. The unceasing power struggle between Roman families and factions was not found there, leaving it a much more stable and peaceful environment. The papacy survived in relative peace, though the cardinals grew worldly and powerful. Prompted by the Dominican tertiary, St. Catherine of Siena, 1347 to 1380, Pope Gregory XI returned the Holy See to Rome in 1377. He died on March 27, 1378. Elect an Italian or die. Gregory XI's death left the citizens of Rome demanding an end to French domination over the papacy. In order to ensure that none of the cardinals would leave before the papal conclave, all roads leading out of Rome were barricaded and the oars and rudders of all boats in the Tiber were confiscated. The cardinals themselves were threatened. The French cardinal Jean de Croce was warned, "Give us an Italian or a Roman pope, or all the cardinals from beyond the Alps will be knifed." As bonfires blazed in the streets, an angry mob burst into the room where the papal conclave was taking place. While the guards were fighting to hold them back, some of the cardinals hastily dressed the aged Roman cardinal Teboldeschi in pontifical robes, put him on the throne, and left him to his fate. But he refused to continue with the masquerade, telling the people, "I am not the pope. They have elected a better one, the Archbishop of Bari." The delay was, however, long enough for the French cardinals to get away. They climbed over the roofs and dropped out of windows to escape the swords. It was an ignominious end to an undignified night's work. Within a short time, several of them had barricaded themselves for safety in the Castle Sant'Angelo, Hadrian's mausoleum on the west bank of the Tiber. Others hid in odd corners of the city, but some merely went to their rooms in the Vatican and waited for the noise to die down. None of them was actually harmed in any way. Pope Urban VI. The cardinals unanimously chose a compromise candidate for pope, a man who had ties with both Italy and France. On April 8, 1378, they elected Bartholomew Prignano, who became Pope Urban VI, 1378 to 1389. Prignano had previously been the Archbishop of Bari and administrator of the Papal States. Under the papacy of Gregory XI, the Papal Palace had been moved from the Lateran Hill to Vatican Hill, an area that had been donated by the Roman Senate and given to Pope Gregory XI. Thus, Pope Urban VI was the first pontiff to be elected in the Vatican. He was crowned pope on Easter Sunday. The cardinals, though fearful of the wrath of the crowds outside the conclave, admitted to having taken part in a free election and certified this fact on the following day when they met with the pope individually. They each agreed in the affirmative that the election was legitimate and coincided with canonical protocol, even signing a document to that effect. Urban VI was sincere in his desire to reform the worldly lifestyle of the cardinals, but he often added insult to injury by his modus operandi. His lack of tact and his abrasive ways generated innumerable enemies. It may be said in favor of Urban's proposed reforms that there was too much pomp and wealth surrounding the lives of the cardinals of the 14th century, that bishops spent too much time away from their dioceses, that simony deserved to be punished, that the immorality, excessive luxury, and lascivity which had become proverbial while the papal court was at Avignon should be banished from the papal curia at Rome. However, despite the recognition by churchmen of the urgency of reform in those areas, Urban's severe approach and insulting methods lost him the sympathy and cooperation of many who would have made personal sacrifices to help him reform the church from top to bottom. Instead, the Pope drove cardinals, bishops, and ambassadors from Rome with hurtful words. The church remained unreformed, and what was far worse and more destructive of bodies and souls, the ensuing conflict between Urban VI and the cardinals developed into a great rebellion. In a word, Urban undisputably acted and ruled as pope, but it was during these crucial weeks following his election that he showed his true weaknesses, an uncontrolled temper, megalomania, and extreme rudeness in consistory. The burden of the papacy was obviously too great for a man who was not born a ruler, but was an exemplary administrator. His aim as pope was to replace the oligarchy practiced at Avignon by the monarchy of the pope. What can hardly be doubted is the tactlessness and lack of wisdom he displayed in pursuing this policy. Conditions ripe for the Western Schism. The predominance of French cardinals, the long exile from Rome, and the mannerisms of Pope Urban VI all helped create the ideal conditions for the Western Schism, 1378 to 1417. Since the Italian pope dwelt in Rome, the influence of France on the papacy began to wane. The French cardinals were mortified by his tirades and reforms and thought the new pope should return to France. The fickleness of the cardinals during this period brings to mind an anecdote that was to take place centuries later. It is said that Napoleon Bonaparte, so often at odds with the Vatican, once told a cardinal, "The church is my enemy. I will destroy her." The cardinal replied, "I don't think you will. We cardinals have been trying to destroy her for centuries, and we haven't been able to do it." Unfortunately, the general laxity, worldliness, and personal ambition of the cardinals played a key role in the creation of the Western Schism. Cardinal Robert of Geneva, cousin of King Charles V of France, instigated the French cardinals against Urban VI and declared the election invalid on the grounds of duress and coercion. Years earlier, he had commanded the papal army in a war against Florence and its allies, acquiring the infamous name Butcher of Cesena for his massacre of 3,000 women and children during one of his campaigns. Anti-Pope Clement VII. The 13 French cardinals left Rome on September 20, 1378, and elected the anti-pope Cardinal Robert, who took the name Clement VII, 1378 to 1394. The remarkable feature of this double election was that one and the same college of cardinals had elected two popes within a few months. In the numerous previous schisms, this contingency had never occurred. The cardinals had acknowledged Urban VI as the rightful pope throughout the 5 months following the election. They had begged his favors, even when they had repaired to Anangi and Fondi. With Urban firmly installed in Rome, Clement was obliged to go to Avignon and settle there 10 months after his election. When Urban died in October 1389, Clement thought that his return to Rome was assured. But the opulence of his court and costs of his single-minded diplomacy meant that he had turned into a harsh tax collector, and this undermined his support. What is more, the schism caused by his election in 1378 and continued by that of Pope Boniface IX in 1389 was increasingly unpopular. Anti-Pope Benedict XIII. The French cardinals pressured Clement to resign, but he fell victim to a fatal apoplectic seizure before this occurred. Following Clement's death, the Avignon cardinals elected another anti-pope, Peter de Luna of Aragon, who took the name Benedict XIII, 1394 to 1424. However, the clergy of France on two separate occasions withdrew their obedience to him because of his failure to put an end to the schism. The anti-pope was even abandoned by the King of France during the years 1398 to 1403. A divided Europe. As a result of the confusion, Europe itself was also divided. Northern and central Italy, Corsica, Portugal, England, Ireland, Austria, Hungary, Scandinavia, and Poland remained faithful to the Roman pontiff. Scotland, Spain, France, southern Italy, Sicily, and Sardinia showed allegiance to the anti-popes of Avignon. Germany, Switzerland, and the central European nations shifted loyalties between the two opposing camps whenever it suited their purpose. There were now two sets of cardinals and two claimants to the chair of Peter, one in Rome and one in Avignon. Some parishes had two priests, each loyal to a different pope. Monasteries had multiple abbots. Families were divided. Nations were divided. The church was divided. Even holy men and women, doctors of canon law, and theologians were perplexed by the dilemma. A contemporary of the Western Schism, St. Antoninus, Archbishop of Florence, testified, "There were many discussions about this matter and many books written in defense of both sides. Through all the time that the division lasted, both parts or obediences could count among their supporters men exceedingly learned, both in theology and canon law, and also men of most holy life, and what is more striking still, outstanding by the miracles they wrought. Yet it was never possible so to decide the question that no doubts remained in the minds of the majority of men." It will be remembered that St. Catherine of Siena and St. Bridget declared themselves in favor of Pope Urban, while St. Vincent Ferrer and Blessed Peter of Luxembourg paid respect and obedience to the French anti-pope. Thus distracted, the Christian world was divided into two camps, and it was no uncommon sight to see two prelates or two abbots to settle their right to a benefice granted by the pope of their choice, by force of arms. At the grassroots level, however, the church still functioned. Mass was celebrated, the gospel was preached, the sacraments were provided, and works of charity went on. But for many, the papacy had lost credibility. Many people in good faith followed anti-popes during this period, since it was difficult to ascertain who was the legitimate successor of St. Peter. Their personal conviction was not a matter of faith, therefore they remained Catholic. The Roman line. In contrast to the anti-popes, Urban VI was a legitimate pope who died in 1389 and was succeeded in turn by Popes Boniface IX, 1389-1404, Innocent VII, 1404-1406, and Gregory XII, 1406-1415. The pontiffs of the Roman line are considered the legitimate popes. The pontificate of Boniface IX did nothing to help end the Western Schism. He excessively taxed both clergy and laity, as did many of the popes and anti-popes of the period. Though an able, even outstanding administrator, Boniface IX was infamous for his blatant nepotism and financial skullduggery. Because of the papacy's desperate need for money, he openly sold church offices to the highest bidders. The illegitimate Council of Pisa. The universities of Oxford, Paris, and Prague believed that they could put an end to the schism by convoking a general council at Pisa. Sadly, they only made matters worse by the introduction of another anti-pope. Following the death of Pope Boniface IX, the Roman cardinals were willing to end the schism if the anti-pope of Avignon, Benedict XIII, would abdicate. Benedict refused, and thus alienated his powerful allies, the French court and the University of Paris. In addition, his heavy taxation made further enemies. Representatives from across Christendom met at the Cathedral of Pisa on March 23, 1409, to put an end to the Western Schism. Most of the cardinals proceeded to abandon the two opposing popes, Gregory XII in Rome and Benedict XIII in Avignon, and elect another. Neither the Roman pope nor the Avignon anti-pope were in attendance. They were deposed and excommunicated by this Council of Pisa on June 5, 1409, and another new anti-pope, Alexander V, was elected on June 26. By the time the council opened in Pisa, almost the whole body of the followers of the rival popes had deserted to the neutral position of the cardinals and their council. It was numerically a splendid gathering and very representative, 500 active members, that is to say voters, at the great sessions where the popes were condemned, of whom 84 were bishops. There were besides 100 representatives of cathedral chapters, representatives of 13 universities, and 300 doctors, either of theology or of canon law, now for the first time here given a vote. The General Council had indeed a new look. It greatly resembled a parliament, a single-chamber parliament. 17 reigning princes sent ambassadors. Another novel feature was the absolute unanimity of the council. The two rivals disposed of, that is, excommunicated and deposed, it was the council that bade the cardinals set up a conclave and fill the presumed vacant throne. After 10 days' seclusion, they elected the Archbishop of Milan, who took the style of Alexander V and was duly crowned. He, too, was a very old man, and within the year he died. Whereupon the cardinals elected the strong man of the Council of Pisa, Baldassare Cossa, who called himself by a name that is lately familiar to all of us, John XXIII. The situation was an ecclesiastical nightmare. There were now 3 popes and 3 colleges of cardinals, in some dioceses, 3 rival bishops, and in some religious orders, 3 rival superiors. The schism called for immediate action. There were 3 popes now, as there had been 365 years before, and the emperor then had stifled the schism by deposing all 3. Might not a similar solution be possible in the present difficulty? The Council of Pisa is considered to be an illegitimate council, since it was never approved by the reigning pope, Gregory XII, and was conducted outside of the official auspices of the Church. In judging whether a council is legitimate or illegitimate, it should be noted that a general council is not considered legitimate until it is approved by the pope or his delegate. Based on this fact, a number of church councils have been condemned in the past. Some councils even taught blatant heresy. And here's a little table of the Western Schism. In the Roman line, legitimate popes were Urban VI, 1378 to 89, Boniface IX, 89 to 04, Innocent VII, 1404 to 06, and Gregory XII, 1406 to 15. The Avignon line, or the anti-popes, were Clement VII, 1378 to 1394, and Benedict XIII, 1394 to 1417. And the Pisan line of anti-popes were Alexander V, 1409 to 10, and John XXIII, 1410 to 1415. Dark days for the Church. These were terribly dark days for the Catholic faithful, who once again found themselves unable to distinguish the true shepherds from the hirelings. Even a person's sanctity was no guarantee of his ability to recognize a true pope. Furthermore, those churchmen who held legitimate offices were themselves frequently scandalous individuals. As the months stretched into years and the years into decades, it must have seemed that the chaos would never end. 40 years of wandering in the wilderness where no one knew with certainty who was head of the church. 40 years where unity of belief was marvelously preserved, but in which administrative chaos reigned, and there sprang up an abundance of anarchical theories about the nature of the papacy and its role. Yet, this very depth of confusion, while distressing to those who endured it, served to illuminate with great brilliance the divine character of Holy Mother Church. It also indicated very compellingly how woefully inadequate are the perspectives of the human intellect. The Catholic Church remains the indestructible bark of Peter, guided only in appearance by the calculations and maneuverings of men, but in reality by Christ himself. Ominous signs. Rome was devastated by a tremendous storm on January 29, 1411. Some inhabitants were terrified, believing it to be a sign of impending calamity. On April 12, 1411, the anti-pope John XXIII finally gained control of the Vatican and triumphantly entered St. Peter's. During the illegitimate council held in Rome in 1412, a strange occurrence left an ominous feeling over the entire assembly. The Mass of the Holy Spirit had been said, the congregation were devoutly seated, and Pope or Antipope John had taken his place on his throne when a ghastly bird of the night, a screech owl, flew with horrid outcry from a dark corner of the church and perched opposite the Pope with large threatening eyes. John reddened and perspired. Finally, he rose from his seat and the congregation dispersed. But at the next assembly, the bird again appeared and again fixed its black eyes on the pontiffs. Some of the cardinals laughed. John ordered them to chase the bird of ill omen away. They rose in a body, waved their staves, shrieked at the owl, but it was some time before they made it budge. Finally, they knocked it down and killed it, but the memory of the evil omen remained. The anti-pope John XXIII signed a peace pact with King Ladislaus of Naples on June 15, 1412. As a result of the negotiations, Pope Gregory XII, the legitimate pope, was exiled from the city of Gaeta on October 13, 1412, finally reaching the port of Ancona on Christmas Eve, 1412. Pope Gregory then found refuge in the domain of Carlo Malatesta, the Lord of Rimini. This was the only area in Italy that remained faithful to the legitimate pope. Emperor Sigismund. The Holy Roman Emperor Rupert of the Palatinate died on May 18, 1410, and three powerful kings vied for the throne. Sigismund, son of Emperor Charles IV, finally triumphed and was crowned on July 21, 1411. He believed the dilemma of having three popes and a kingdom with divided loyalties had to be remedied as soon as possible. Sigismund was the only individual who had the strength of character and resources to end the schism. His fluency in seven languages, his regal bearing, and strength of character assured his ultimate success. In 1414, King Ladislaus of Naples attacked Rome and threatened the rest of Italy. The anti-pope John XXIII feared that Ladislaus would attack Pisa next and therefore called upon Sigismund for aid. A deal was struck. Sigismund would come to his defense on the condition that John XXIII would convoke a general council in his domain. The anti-pope had no choice but to obey. The Council of Constance. This council, which would be called the Council of Constance, would hopefully accomplish two things. It would put an end to the schism, for all three claimants to the papacy would be asked to resign, and a new pontiff would then be elected. And it would put an end to the civil and religious strife caused by the heresies of John Huss in Bohemia and its environs. The church was also in dire need of reform. Although the Council of Constance would address the issue, it would remain for the Council of Trent, 1545 to 1563, to put an end to many of the abuses that plagued the church, especially among the clergy. Most general councils of the church prior to the Council of Constance lasted for several months to a year. Constance would last for four long years. It began on November 16, 1414, and ended on April 22, 1418. All 45 sessions of the council were held in the Bishop's Cathedral in Constance. The cathedral, built in the 11th century on the foundation of a Roman fort, was the seat of one of the oldest bishoprics, and as such, the logical location for a gathering of the church's highest officials. The city of Constance is today known as the Twin Cities of Konstanz, Germany, and Kreuzlingen, Switzerland. In the 15th century, it was known as a fishing village and a producer of fine linen. Its population of 10,000 grew tenfold from 1414 to 18 as clergy, royalty, and peasantry gathered for the historic council. Not all its members by any means were assembled by the opening date, but ultimately there were present, it is held, 600 ecclesiastics with a say in the council, 183 of them bishops, 300 doctors of theology and canon law, and an innumerable horde of less important clerics, and the suites of these magnificent ecclesiastical lords from Germany especially. Gallicanism. The writings of men who had lived years earlier began to have a profound effect on clergy and laity alike. William of Ockham, 1280 to 1349, who opposed the abuses and worldliness of the Avignon popes, advocated theories that destroyed the concept of the papacy as a divine institution. Ockham befriended the avowed enemies of the Avignon popes, Louis of Bavaria, Marsilius of Padua, and Michael of Cesena. The University of Paris was the catalyst for novel, erroneous concepts that were championed by clergy and laity alike during this period. The superiority of a general council over the pope and the fallibility of the pope were taught at the university, and the Cardinal Bishop of Cambrai, Peter Dailly, echoed these erroneous concepts at the Council of Constance. Gallicanism may be defined in general as the tendency, while accepting the papacy as of divine institution, to oppose or minimize the papal claims as they have been made in history. It has been of two kinds, political and theological. Political Gallicanism contested the claims to authority in the temporal order as asserted and exercised by Gregory VII, Innocent III, and Boniface VIII. Theological Gallicanism contested certain claims of the papacy in the spiritual and religious order. These tendencies, of course, manifested themselves in other countries than France. They have received the name Gallican because all through history it has been in France that they have found their chief expression. Gallicanism, also called conciliarism, taught that a general council is superior to the pope and that a pope must pay obeisance to a general council. Marsilius of Padua, the rector of the University of Paris from December 1312 to March 1313, claimed that authority ultimately resided in the people and that the pope received his jurisdiction from the state. This erroneous teaching destroys the concept that the pope receives his authority from Christ, and the clergy thereby become mere representatives of the state. The main point of conciliarism was that power was not located in the papal monarch, but in the church itself as represented by the general council. In this system, the pope was merely a representative of the general council and eventually of the church. It was the latter from which he received power and to which he consequently remained responsible. Hitherto the master of the church, he was now turned into its servant. The pope became an officer, an organ of the church, which could restrict, modify, and take away the power conferred on him by the general council. Conciliarism was the exact opposite of the papal monarchy. Division into national groups. Anti-Pope John XXIII planned to legitimize his claim to the papal throne by means of the council, since most of Europe already showed allegiance to him. In order to prevent John from using the council to his own advantage, it was decided that the nations of Europe would be divided into an electoral college. Each bloc of nations would receive equal representation and voting rights. The French, Italians, and Spaniards each had their own bloc. The German bloc included the Scandinavians, Hungarians, Dalmatians, Czechs, Croatians, and Poles. The English bloc included the Scots and Irish. This procedure prevented any of the three claimants to the papal throne from seizing control of the council and allowed all nations an equal voice in the proceedings. Anti-Pope John XXIII. In January 1415, the Council of Constance started to seriously scrutinize the evil life of John XXIII. The bishops objected to his simoniacal intrigue at his election, his immorality, his faithless utterances, and his irreligious conduct. Both Roman Catholic and Protestant church historians agree that John XXIII was a scoundrel of the First Order. He seems to have been a pirate from a family of pirates prior to his ecclesiastical career. After entering the services of the church, he so impressed Boniface IX with his ability to increase papal revenues that he was made a papal legate of Bologna. While serving in this capacity, he became the undisputed master of the city and in the process incurred the wrath of Ladislaus, king of Naples and protector of Gregory XII. Cosa's elevation to the throne of Peter did not change his moral standards, his greed, or his politics. He was feared and hated by his enemies, mistrusted and ridiculed by his friends. Monsignor Creighton, in his authoritative work on the papacy, says, "It was a grotesque and blasphemous incongruity to look upon such a man as the vicar of Christ. Though a churchman and a cardinal, he was still only a deacon, a layman in all but name. Church routine occupied but little of his time. Church matters had necessarily entered little into his thoughts. There were those who said he had never confessed nor taken the sacrament. There were those who alleged that he believed not in the resurrection of the dead. He was above all things a soldier, fitter for the sword than the cassock, taking more delight in buckler and helmet than in pall or vestments, an able man in temporal matters, but of no account in affairs spiritual. He was a man who would do better as king or emperor than as pope." A pamphlet was distributed listing many of the crimes of the former pirate, irreligious soldier, and scandalous prelate. There were also allegations which remain to this day that he poisoned his predecessor, the anti-pope Alexander V. Flight from Constance. John XXIII realized that he would have to resign his illegitimate claim to the papacy. To prevent this, he organized a sensational tournament for the emperor and for all those who attended the council on March 20, 1415. Under cover of darkness, he escaped from Constance in the disguise of a stable hand and found asylum in the territory of Duke Frederick of Austria in the city of Schaffhausen, Switzerland, 30 miles away. He remained there from March 21st to the 29th. John XXIII hoped this action would bring about the termination of the council proceedings. Hundreds fled the city in fear, and Sigismund found it necessary to ride on horseback through the streets of Constance, threatening anyone who dared to leave the city before the council was completed. Thus, the bishops and theologians stayed in Constance, and the council continued. Having thus calmed the public distress, the king then assembled all the prelates and secular dignitaries and assured them that he would, at the peril of his life, maintain the council. The king's resolution and courage appeased the tumult in all minds. The lords, spiritual and temporal, knew that the council was safe and would continue. The shopkeepers reopened their shops. The Florentine bankers and money changers were reassured. The town was quieted, and the ordinary life of the place resumed its wanton aspect. Duke Frederick of Austria and the anti-pope John XXIII would pay dearly for their cowardice and treachery. On March 25, 1415, Sigismund and the council declared that all subjects of the duke were released from their allegiance to him. All lands of the duke would become property of the emperor. John XXIII lost nearly all his supporters, including his cardinals and close relatives. On Good Friday, March 29, 1415, the anti-pope and the duke left Schaffhausen with the emperor's army in hot pursuit. The cardinals scattered, some returning in disguise to Constance, while others fled to Rome. John XXIII next made his way through the Black Forest and finally reached Freiburg, Germany, just a few miles from the Burgundian border. Duke Frederick joined the anti-pope, but the curtain was coming down fast as 40,000 soldiers of Sigismund's army were rapidly advancing. The duke's domains were being overrun, and his allies deserted him. Their only hope lay in John of Burgundy, who, however, feared a war with Sigismund and offered no assistance. He would leave them to their own fate. Betrayed. Duke Frederick was not of a character to be trusted. This man, who had assassinated his own cousin in his rise to power, would soon betray the anti-pope. An incognito, John XXIII made a mad dash for liberty on April 25th. He found a contingent of the duke's cavalry and joined them as they made their way to the city of Nuremberg, Germany. The anti-pope then fled from the city during the night and arrived at Breisach, Germany, a broken man and a victim of Duke Frederick's plan. On April 27th, the duke handed John XXIII over to Sigismund in exchange for a merciful sentence for himself. John XXIII was apprehended within sight of the Burgundian border, which he was never able to reach. The anti-pope was finally arrested on May 17th and put on trial by Sigismund and the Council of Constance for his flight and for the serious crimes he committed before and after his supposed election. These included, among other things, the allegation of murdering his predecessor, piracy, simony, sacrilege, immorality, incest, and adultery. Although John XXIII was charged on 72 counts, many charges were dropped to avoid scandal. During the 11th session of the council held on May 23, 1415, he was charged on 54 proven counts. The anti-pope was solemnly and formally deposed during the 12th session on May 29th, and was sentenced to imprisonment at Heidelberg Castle. This is the end of Side 7, continued on Side 8.